entitled First Folio, the book that gave us Shakespeare.
Thank you, Walter, and I highly recommend doing a brown bag talk in September and getting one of Walter's introductions just to get you ready for the year. It's always very, very nice to hear. Thank you all so much for coming on a beautiful day. I know I thought I was competing with the President's Address. Those of you that sat through the President's Address and now came to this, well done. This talk is not obviously a talk presenting any kind of original scholarship. It is a talk which is once informational, promotional, and solicitous, which is, I'm going to talk about a grant that Wayne State University received, a grant that sends us Shakespeare's First Folio. And what the First Folio is, I suppose I should explain that, or I always think that's maybe self-evident, but Shakespeare's First Folio is an incredibly important book because it's the book that gave us Shakespeare. Without the First Folio, to quote the Beatles, Shakespeare would be half the man we thought he would be. 18 plays really would have been lost, and probably 18 more would have come to down to us in significantly different form. So without the First Folio, quite literally, without this incredible publishing effort and this incredible artifact that now exists only in rare form, you wouldn't have Shakespeare. And without Shakespeare, you really wouldn't have the Anglo-American literary canon. And I know for some folks maybe that's a good thing, but the fact of the matter is that would take out a great piece of who we are. And so we're going to have this wonderful artifact coming to Detroit, coming to the DIA, because members of the Wayne State English Department, Wayne State Libraries in particular, who have been fantastic and just great people to work with, brought us together with the Detroit Institute of Arts and the Detroit Public Library to successfully win a grant from the Folger Shakespeare Library in Washington, D.C., which is one of the top two Shakespeare libraries in the country, along with the Huntington, probably the top one. What the Folger decided to do was take at least 40 of their 82 folios and circulate them to send them each to one group in a state. And Wayne State and DIA and DPL, we were Michigan's recipients. So this is a big deal. And for no other reasons than we beat our good friends up I-94 in this competition, and that sort of rarely happens. So we're delighted with that. And again, this talk is then about that process. It's about what we're planning to do, and those plans are ongoing, I should say. I've got a lot of my collaborators here in the room with me, but in true Shakespearean spirit, I'm opening this up. We invite participation. We invite applause, of course, but we invite you to engage with us because we really want to turn this into a celebration of Detroit, some of its anchor institutions, and Shakespeare. The big dates I've got up here on my first slide are March 10th through April 3rd, 2016. That is when Detroit gets the artifact. And while I'm sitting here, I might as well circulate. Oh, I brought this over here today. These get heavy. This is my copy of the First Folio. This is actually a facsimile. I'm going to pass this around so people can thumb through it and have a sense of what First Folios sort of look like as I'm doing this. You got a hands-on copy. But the big dates are March 10th through April 3rd. That's when all of this gets going. So, given all that said, I'm just going to move in here and talk again a little bit more about the folio and its importance. Again, incredibly important book. There really aren't that many around like it. There's Gutenberg's printed Bible. There's Darwin's Origin of the Species. There's Audubon's first book on birds. These are books that generate other books to catalog what happened to the original books. And of all of these, Shakespeare's First Folio is probably at the top in terms of its influence. The last copy, and money always catches people's attention, I put this up here. The last copy that sold privately at, where else, a Sotheby's auction in 2006, sold for $5.2 million. This is the Williams copy. Most of the folios are known, if possible, by owner's names. The books gain in value if the collectors have some sense of who owned that particular artifact, and then even more so, how much you can track it back. The Williams copy you can track back through a physician's family for a number of years. It's also a remarkably pristine, well-preserved, large copy, no sheets missing, very little damage, and things like this. So this was a sort of extraordinary selling. But I put this slide up here first because, again, money talks. I give you some sense of what these artifacts are like. And by the way, this is where our good friends at the DIA came in. When we applied for this grant, the Folger had all kinds of specifications about what's the humidity in the room, what's going to be the light in the room, what's the condition, how are you going to take care of this. And our libraries, remarkable as they are, quickly determined that we just can't pull that off. But guess what? We know someone nearby who's really, really good at that sort of thing, and they were sort of gracious enough to join with us. And so when the folio comes, it's actually going to be housed at the DIA. And I'll talk more about that as I go along. Again, a bit more information about the first folio itself, just to give you the date. Shakespeare's lifetime, of course, 1564 to 1616. One of the reasons that this is such a big year in Shakespeare studies and in Shakespeareana, it's the 400th year anniversary of his death. And we tend to like to celebrate birth more than death, but we'll get the next sort of 64 in there too. But this is the 400th year anniversary of the death. The folio itself wasn't printed until 1623. And there I give you a list of the individual plays first printed. These, in other words, are plays that we really would have more or less lost as we know them without the folio. Up in the right corner, I've got a couple brief notes there. Interesting, Pericles was probably the most notable play that couldn't find its way into the folio collection. That's because the people who put the folio collection together, co-actors of Shakespeare, John Hemmings and Henry Condell, couldn't get the rights to the existing quarto edition of Pericles. It's Pericles itself is kind of an anomaly. And by the way, I'm going to pass around, this is a quarto, a facsimile of a quarto, so you have a sense of what quartos look like, and I'll talk about that. Here's an image of a quarto, obviously much smaller. These are the single editions to Shakespeare's plays that were printed at the time period. These were sold, these were used by acting company, they were pirated. They were obviously much smaller. That's because when you took the big sheaf of paper, you could fold it into four sides rather than the folio, which you just sort of bent over in half, and it was much larger and much more expensive. But a lot of the plays, of course, exist in quarto form. The folio is interesting as an artifact because there really wasn't anything like it. When Shakespeare's fellow actors decided to pay him this tribute 7 years after his death. The first playwright to put out a folio that had, the first folio to come out that had plays in it was put out 7 years earlier by Shakespeare's great rival, Ben Jonson, in the works 7 years earlier, and it was put out by Jonson himself. And he met with a lot of criticism because at the time this was considered very arrogant, egotistical. Not that Jonson wasn't used to that kind of criticism. In fact, he invited it and delighted in it and played with it all the time. But when he put out his first folio, which had mass and entertainment and poems and other things in it, he added some plays. And folks thought this was very, very strange because plays at that time were more ethereal. There wasn't that much interest in keeping them in print or circulating in the way we would circulate plays today, because plays were part of a production. You put them on, you got them together as best you could, you distributed what roles were accessible to the right actors at the right time, you had the performance, and then you moved on. There was certainly some money to be had in printing and selling the plays, but not that much, number one. And number two, in terms of artistry, playwriting was not up there with poetry writing. So the only time a folio, the production of a folio had been considered, was by Ben Jonson. a few years, actually in the year of Shakespeare's death, and there's a nice shot of Johnson. I put that up there. Johnson's a critical figure in our understanding of Shakespeare. You get a sense of Johnson there. That's more or less his image bears, I think, shows something of his personality. He was a brilliantly educated guy, a great classicist, but he was not to be toyed with. He was, you know, tried for murder in what might be considered today a bar fight. Smart enough to escape because he knew Latin and got away with just a little sort of branding on the hand. But Johnson is important to us. He's an important figure in his own right, but he's important because he shaped our whole understanding of Shakespeare. Johnson was the artist who said, art should be a certain way. Playwriting should be a certain way. When I put on a play, I want you to watch this play, and it's going to purge all your ugly emotions. In other words, I know what's best for you. I'm going to write these plays. You're going to watch them. I'm going to make you better because I know what's best. That is fundamentally opposite from Shakespeare's quintessential gestures, which are almost always welcoming, hospitable, as you like it, what you will. And those are real distinctions, but those are also distinctions that became marketing, or, you know, it's too early in history to say marketing, but pre-marketing tools. Johnson and Shakespeare played these differences off one another to sell each other. When Shakespeare would talk about, when Johnson would talk about Shakespeare, he played up, for example, Shakespeare's lack of language training. But at the same time, he played up what has become a standard understanding of Shakespeare, that he was something of a natural genius, right? That he really didn't need classical training, that he didn't need special training in any way. He was just a natural genius. And this actually comes out of the First Folio. That sort of understanding of Shakespeare is perhaps best embodied in one of the eulogies, one of the several eulogies that first appeared in the First Folio. And you can take a look at some of the excerpted lines there. To the memory of my beloved Mr. William Shakespeare, while I confess thy writings to be such as neither man nor muse can praise too much, soul of the age, the applause, delight, the wonder of our stage, my Shakespeare, rise. I will not lodge thee by Chaucer or Spenser, of course the great poet laureates who had preceded Shakespeare chronologically, or bid Beaumont lie a little further. Beaumont, one of the great playwrights who worked a bit with Shakespeare and worked mostly with Fletcher. To me thee a room and art alive still, while thy book doth live and tell how far thou didst our Lily outshine. Lily, another playwright of the time. And then a reference to Sporting Kid or Marlowe, mighty line. And here are the most famous lines from Johnson that again have shaped our understanding of Shakespeare ever since. And though thou hadst small Latin and less Greek, he was not of an age, but for all time. And this always strikes me as a sort of classic academic praise, which is, the minute I'm going to say something nice about you, I'm also going to get in the left hook. In other words, you're not that well educated, but you're pretty bright and sort of pretty popular. Again, this is, we know this kind of discourse. This is how we tend to talk to one another at the same time. But this is Johnson's eulogy inside the Folio. And here is the first. This is the opening pages of the Folio, which, by the way, was put out by the Stationers Company, Edward Blunt, and a father-son team of William and Isaac Jagger. The father, William, dies just before publication. I've got to talk about them a little bit. But this is what you see more or less when you first open the Folio, and the reader on the far side of the text, that's Ben Johnson. And the famous portrait, which is so familiar to everyone, the Drujout portrait on the right-hand side. Martin Drujout, by the way, was at the time 20-year-old Flemish emigre. He was an engraver. And presumably Hemmings and Condell, and I'm going to talk about them next, they must have supplied him with more than a verbal description of their friend. Drujout must have based his work upon some pre-existing source, although we don't know what that is, perhaps a drawing or even an oil painting now long lost. And we know this because engravers of this kind, where they were copyists and not police sketch artists. So that image is important because it logically it seems to connect in some way to what Shakespeare actually looked like. It's probably the best image we have of the man himself. Another sort of part of this is these are the list of names of the principal actors here. At the top of the list, of course, is William Shakespeare. The next list on the list is Richard Burbage, and the next on the list is John Hemmings. And I had that image here, the list of the actors, sorry, because in talking about the First Folio and telling this story, it's really important It's really important to understand something about Hemmings and Condell. And if we know something about Hemmings and Condell, we know something about Shakespeare. They were, along with Richard Burbage, the two fellow actors who were in Shakespeare's will. And Shakespeare writes in his will, "My fellow John Hemmings, Richard Burbage, and Henry Condell, he provided them with 26 shillings each to buy them rings in remembrance of Shakespeare." These rings would have been, this money would have been meant for rings that were quite ornate, but quite depressing in a way. You're walking around and, with these rings on your hand of some sort of image or recollection of your dead friend. But this group of folks, this group of actors, had been together a long time. Hemmings and Condell, as far as we can tell, had been with Shakespeare working as a troupe of actors since the early 1590s, and now we're up at 1623. So for them to undertake this exercise, along with a bit of help from Burbage, but for Hemmings and Condell to undertake this exercise, you get some sense of Shakespeare the man, Shakespeare the collaborator. When I talk to undergrads, one of the things I always have to explain to them about Shakespeare is he's an early modernist. And by that, his understanding of art was one of improvisation, was one of collaboration. He was not someone who worked independently, alone, a 19th century romantic poet. Part of Shakespeare's genius, in other words, was his ability to work together, to bring teams together, and particularly as enacting troupes. So we all have enough sort of human experience to understand that no matter what your talents are, no matter what your professional accomplishments are, that at the end of your career, people are only going to say nice things about you and do nice things for you if, one, it benefits them. I don't want to get too soppy about this. Two, if they liked you. If there was some human warmth or affection between the people involved. So when you're looking at the First Folio or seeing the First Folio, I think one of the things you're seeing is literally that spirit of Shakespearean collaboration and partnership and engagement, that willingness to sort of give up the self to work as part of a team of actors and people that stayed together a long time. Burbage was the son of the great theater owner, the entrepreneur James Burbage, who built the first standing theater in 1576 on the far side of the Thames, right now where the London Wall is in the financial district. This is the great actor who played Hamlet, Richard III, Othello, King Lear, along with Edward Allen, who didn't always work with Shakespeare's troupe, only occasionally. These were the monumental theatrical figures of the time. Hemmings and Condell weren't quite that impressive on the stage, but nonetheless, they were part of the troupe. Hemmings, again, as I said, they were with him from the 1590s with the Lord Chamberlain's men, Shakespeare's first patron, who later became fellow shareholders in the King's men. And important to understand, because of this relationship, this friendship, these two folks would have had access to original sources of all kinds now lost, right? When we ask, where did the First Folio come from? Where did the text come from? Certainly some of it came from printed quartos, and you can sort that out now digitally and electronically and see where those sort of match up. But there's all sorts of mysteries. There's all sorts of textual mysteries about where the original text came from. One important thing to note, when we look at these printed books, and it's hard always talking about printed manuscript with Arthur sitting in the room, but when you look at these texts, these printed texts, we don't have any manuscripts from Shakespeare. Now, this is not to raise sort of weird conspiracy sort of theory discussions. Shakespeare was Shakespeare, and I invite you to read James Shapiro's Contested Will if you've got questions about that. It's a wonderful airplane book, by the way. You can get it done in 2 hours, and you'll be captivated by the story. But we don't have any of Shakespeare's hand. Again, what we do have is the First Folio, which is the careful work of his good colleagues and his good friends of over 20 years,
who wanted to set this right, okay? Condell over on the other side is the younger of the two. Obviously, when he was on stage, he was the sort of guy that was able to convey somebody's best friend, right? The loyal best friend, Benvolio and Romeo and Juliet. Everyone's classic best friend, Horatio in Hamlet. A little bit different, Oliver and As You Like It. And they both lived probably in the same neighborhood, at least in the same parish. This is a great poem. This is a great discussion, actually, a great piece of literary evidence. Not great poetry in terms of its literary value, but in terms of what it tells you about these two folks. This is an anonymous poem that appeared after the theater fire of 1613 that destroyed the Globe Theater. There was a presentation of Henry VIII, or All Is True, and the cannon fire that was exploded caught the roof on fire, and it was a disaster because the Globe Theater was now owned by Shakespeare's men, and this caused quite a stir. Shakespeare, by the way, had been retired by this time. He was back up in Stratford, living the life of a gentleman and enjoying the four short years of retirement he had. But let me just read this quickly. This fearful fire began above, a wonder strange and true, and to the stage house did remove as round as tailor's clue. And burned down both beam and stag, and did not spare the silken flag. Oh, sorrow, pitiful sorrow, and yet all this is true, making fun of the play, of course, the play title that was going on when this fire took place. Outrun the knights, outrun the lords, and there was great ado. Some lost their hats and some their swords, then outrun Burbage, too. The reprobates, though drunk on Monday, prayed for the fool, whether that's Will Kemp, we don't know, and Henry Condé. Oh, sorrow, pitiful sorrow, and yet all this is true. The periwigs and drumheads fry like to a butter firkin. A woeful burning did betide to many a good buff jerkin. Then with swollen eyes like drunken Flemings, distressed stood old stuttering Hemings. Oh, sorrow, pitiful sorrow, yet all is true. This might be a reason John Hemings really never had great roles. He had a bit of a stutter, apparently. But he was also took over as the theatrical manager of the troupe. Apparently he had great administrative skills. This is some of another shot of the preliminary pages of the first folio, listing the catalogs, comedies, histories, tragedies. Later editors only added the category of romances. This is some of Hemings and Condell. You really can't obviously see the print from there, but it's available in the facsimile if you want to take a closer look at it. This is the two compilers. This is really an important page for Shakespearean scholars and for us to understand the man in his plays, because some of the things that are in this text have, again, informed our shape of understanding of Shakespeare, but they also happen to be true. In other words, you always want to be careful of what is marketing, what is self-promotion, what is rhetorical self-presentation and that sort of thing in reading early modern texts or any text. But whatever this is, because of the close familiarity of the people involved, there has to be some truth to this. In this passage, Hemings and Condell appeal to the great variety of readers. Right? They are suggesting to us what Shakespeare wanted to suggest as a man of the theater and as a businessman, that Shakespeare was for all. Generally by that meant all social classes, right? From the most able to him that can but spell, and we are still living in a time of limited literacy. That's when the first folio was printed, there were only probably about 750 copies. It was very difficult to tease out the business math, right? How much money do you want to spend in this sort of production based on how many of these things do you think you can actually sell? But feel free, Hemings and Condell invite their readers, to read and censure. And again, this to me, as a lifelong Shakespeare reader, scholar, fan, is quintessential Shakespeare. Shakespeare is constantly inviting criticism. He is constantly inviting audiences to join in. Give me your hands, as you like it, what you will, right? If you don't like this, we'll make amends. We can work this out, in other words. But by all means, come to the theater and participate. And again, this is the exact opposite of Ben Jonson, who basically says to his readers and his viewers, you're not very bright. Let me help you out, right? Pay attention to what I say. Also, again, is the Shakespearean pragmatism. this ends, after all the sort of more laudatory and sentimental lines, it ends with, but whatever you do, bye, right? Shakespeare was also, amongst other things, a tremendous businessman. He was smart enough, along with Burbage and Hemings and Kandel, early in this venture to become not just an actor, not just a playwright, another, not just a paid stiff, but an owner, which allowed him to retire. They provide, too, a first extra theatrical glimpse of the natural genius narrative I was talking about. They say, his mind and hand went together, and what he thought, he uttered with that easiness that we have scarce received from him a blot in his papers. In other words, Shakespeare never rewrote, or he never sort of, you know, revised, which is difficult to believe, but of course we have zero evidence of any, you know, manuscript sort of copy. But again, this is the world of the theater. Shakespeare worked within that context. He had incredibly talented friends, incredibly sophisticated theatrical folks, so when they put on plays, they figured out what worked, what didn't, that sort of thing. But there was, nonetheless, some gracefulness, some ease to Shakespeare's writing, to his work with others, that his closest friends noticed. I mean, this may have been, sort of Michael sitting down, this may have been classic Renaissance sprezzatura, right? A sort of concealed practice. Concealed practice. I felt you back there. A concealed practice of making the difficult look easy when it is fact not. You know, that would have been part of Shakespeare's training too. But given the heartfelt message of Hemings and Kandel, there's something else there too, I think. Importantly, they express regret here that Shakespeare didn't live to do this, but insist that they are setting out to correct errors promulgated, and here we get some really strong language. We're trying to give you the real thing. There's been a lot of diverse, stolen, and surreptitious copies that are maimed and deformed by the frauds and stealth of injurious impostors. In other words, we're sick of other people making money off of our stuff, right, or our friends' stuff, and a lot of it is crap, a lot of it is flawed, so we're going to try to give you the real edition Shakespeare, in some ways, would have wanted them. Intriguingly, one of the people responsible, though, for one of the greatest perpetrations of this kind of fraud was William Jagger, the son of Isaac. He was the printer who put out in 1619 what has now become known as the Pavier Quarto, the famous false folio, which had seven plays of Shakespeare's of different qualities in there. But it was actually the Shakespeare's first folio, 1619, but it wasn't authorized, obviously, by Shakespeare and his friends. But the way London business world works, it looks like Hemings and Kandel had no real market to go to. In other words, had they wanted to go to another printer, other than the one who had put out this false folio, they didn't have other options in town. They had to go back to the Jaggers to put this out. By the way, on the bad quarto, I thought I'd give you an example. When I say bad quartos, and say, you know, sometimes we think of slight changes or typography or something. Here's a sort of a classic example of what a bad quarto would look like. This is, of course, the famous "to be or not to be" speech in Hamlet, Act 3, Scene 2. By the way, this is the page when the Folger sends the DIA the artifact. They're going to have it open to this text. By the way, here's the quarto version of that famous speech. "To be or not to be? Aye, there's the point. To die, to sleep, is that all? Aye, all. No, to sleep, to dream. I marry, there it goes. For in that dream of death, when we awake and born before an everlasting judge, from whence no passenger ever returned, the undiscovered country at whole sight, the happy smile and the accursed damned." That may not sound like this speech as you've heard it before. What it obviously is probably either an actor's poor recall, and this was a big problem in Shakespeare's world, which is actors would memorize their lines and then, using their great triumph, recast it and sell it and put it on for other people, sort of a copyright problem, or it was a very astute listener who took down quite a bit of the speech, but remembered it the way I tend to remember Shakespeare lines when I'm repeating to my undergraduates, sort of in the haste of a language. Well, you know what I'm talking about. We'll go back to the play at some other point in time.
So this is what it's important to understand that what Hemmings and Condell were responding to in part when they talked about stolen and maimed copies circulating around. They were trying to correct a lot of things like that. Let me move on then and sort of move out of the first folio world, because there's another part of this story I want to tell, which is the story of Henry Folger, which is very interesting in and of itself. The folio itself, it took 9 years to sell out. That's at least an estimate. And that estimate is there because the second edition comes out in 1632. The second edition, intriguingly, which is a very valuable edition in and of itself, is available at the Detroit Public Library, and we're going to have that exhibition itself. This is one of those who knew in Detroit certain things, but the Detroit Public Library has a second edition. Second edition is probably best known for its inclusion of Milton, John Milton's verse on Shakespeare, and that's John Milton's first poem in print. But what happens next in the history of transferring Shakespeare out to the rest of the world looks a little bit like this. During this period, the English Civil War comes up, and we have the famous closing of the theaters. The Protestant Puritan population thought the theaters were too showy, too Catholic, frankly, too messy, and they shut down the theaters from 1640 to 1660. So we really lose track of folio publications. When the theaters open back up during the Restoration, this is after 1660, and they kind of open up in a big way and become very popular, that's when we have the third edition of the folio come out. That appears in 1663. By the way, that third folio, I'll skip a line here, that's the rarest, believe it or not, of the folios, of the four folios. And that's because in the London Fire of 1616, most of the third folios were destroyed. The London Fire, one of the greatest disasters in sort of European history, took most of the city, including the Great Church of St. Paul. London Fathers had a plan for preserving books and library materials and things like that, and their plan was to bring all your paper, all your important papers, if there was such an event like this, to St. Paul's and at the bottom of St. Faith's Chapel, which was a stone enclosure that was supposed to be at the time fireproof. So lots of people, this is the best guess, brought their third folios, amongst other papers, to that St. Faith's Chapel, and St. Paul's was holding up fine because it had at the time in a sort of unusual roof that wasn't wood, but the trim around the roof was wood. And so St. Paul's eventually collapsed. It pancaked. I mean, we're very close to September 11th, and I don't mean to bring up awful images, but the stories of the collapse of St. Paul's Church and the sounds and the horror of that size building would have been historically proportionate in some ways, to the 9/11 event. And it presumably destroyed a lot of artifacts like the third folios. But in that play, you had seven new plays. it turns out of those seven new plays, the only one that was actually can be described to Shakespeare is Pericles. Another interesting story about the third edition was it was so good, or so liked, as new editions are, that the Bodleian Library, sort of the library of libraries, as I speak to the library people, who do everything right, they decided that their first folio copy should be whipped off its chain, right? the folio was available in the library on a chain that was attached to the front. I'm sure you've seen some of these things. So you got it. So it was pulled off and replaced by the third edition, which was the brand new edition, and the first folio went who knows where. It's going to turn up later in this sort of history of anyone. It'll turn up later in this story, but it doesn't disappear. But the Bodleian got rid of their first folio. Bad decision. Hang on to your rare books. Fourth folio that appears in 1685. That one is almost an exact replica of the first folio. Very sort of different sort of beast, and that is also going to be available. DPL has one of the DPL has a fourth folio, so we're going to have that available for people to look at too. Fourth folio is wonderful. Unlike Rocky Films, I say there was no fifth folio. Right? The world of the folios stops more or less here, and the transfer of Shakespearean text takes a slightly different path. Starting around 1709,
we start to move into what we might understand as the modern world of Shakespeare editing. This is Nicholas Rowe, who was himself an actor, was hired as an editor, and he starts putting together this multi-volume octavo set, which is, you know, eventually morphs into, this is my David Bevington kind of beat up copy that I still sort of, has all my notes and stuff like that, that we're familiar with. Then we have Alexander Pope, the great 18th century poet, does his version of Shakespeare. Pope, by the way, was one of, you won't be surprised to hear this, Pope was not shy and not short on ego. He probably made the most emendations of any editor in the Shakespeare editing history because he believed he knew what Shakespeare sort of thought. So Pope's edition is very idiosyncratic. It's as much Pope as it is Shakespeare. Then Louis Theobald in 1733, he is really the first, what we would recognize in my world, as the first Shakespeare scholar editor. Okay, he's the first of this long tradition that I would say extends up now to people like David Bevington. Then at the time, this during the 18th century, the great state of Shakespeare, Shakespeareana, starts getting going. We have the Holy Trinity Monument go up in Stratford. 1751, we have the first university lectures at Oxford about Shakespeare. 1765, Samuel Johnson, the great dictionary maker, essayist, puts together his Shakespeare copies. And in 1769, then we have a slight other turn in the transfer of Shakespeare. Now, we move from the editors and the scholar poets into the theater. David Garrick, great actor of the late 18th century, takes this over, right? He becomes the Shakespearean carrier, if you will, transmitter. And he tries a magnificent, huge festival in Shakespeare's hometown of Stratford, which at that time was just a small, sleepy backwater. It wasn't quite the sophisticated tourist place it is now. So when he tried to set up this thing in Stratford, those folks had no idea what was coming. And it turned into a colossal disaster. There was a flood, there were rainstorms, he had set up all these tents. It was a complete meltdown. But it turned into a great public relations move on Garrick's part, because the fact that someone was going to take over a whole town and commit it to this one individual worked well. And then by the start of the early 19th century, we start to see the folios gain collector's value. Let me move on briefly. I've got to move on now to Henry Clay Folger, who's kind of a remarkable figure in and of himself. Folger is the founder of the Folger Shakespeare Library. This is the place which is graciously lending and sending out this books, and what I think is a phenomenal gesture for a museum. Folger was not only a distant relative of the Coffee family, didn't really make his money there. He was an Amherst and then City College fellow who couldn't pay his tuition at Amherst, and met a family called the Pratts as a roommate, and they paid his way back to Amherst. The Pratts were connected to the Standard Oil family, and Pratt got Folger his first job with Rockefeller and Standard Oil in 1880, and by 23, Henry Clay Folger had become John Rockefeller's number two or three man. He was sort of that skilled as a business executive, as a manager. He was incredibly meticulous. You won't be surprised for someone who founded a museum. He was incredibly well organized, incredibly well disciplined, and in many respects, I'll talk about, incredibly modest. But he marries a fellow Shakespeare lover named Emily in 1885. They don't have kids. In 1889, he buys his first fourth edition folio. This is, again, the look-alike, and he buys it for $107. At Bang's auction in New York City. This first folio purchase was really not a good specimen. It was kind of beat up, and that's probably why the cheap price. In 1896, we see him kind of collecting a lot. He tries to get to Rockefeller to buy in. He says, hey, this guy named Marsden Perry, who was another one of these Gilded Age folks, was buying up all the collections. Let's beat him out of a purchase. And Rockefeller says, no deal, but I'll keep giving you money, more money for what you do, and you can buy on your own. So Rockefeller took himself out of the Shakespeare buying business. 1896, he buys a second first folio. This is a Pope Ho copy for $4,500. This was his first real big buy, $40,000. And this is kind of amazing because Folger was doing well, but at this point, again, he was still the hired hand at Standard Oil. This would have been roughly
3/4 of a year's salary for it, this kind of collection. So Folger wasn't just an ostentatious rich person putting these things out. He loved Shakespeare, and he loved the idea of these books and taught himself to become an expert in them. He even starts working with Howard Furness, an old Shakespeare scholar. In 1900, he buys his fifth Firth folio for $9,000. And then his greatest purchase, which is called the Warwick Castle purchase, this had six first folios in it, and a number of other different materials, and he bought that for $50,000. At the same time, he's still buying flawed copies as they come up and on the market for as low as $900. So this gives you a sense of what this guy's collecting habits were like and what his interests were. And by the way, he's doing this on the sly. In other words, he's not publicizing this. He's going through agents. He's tracking them down himself. When he buys these things, he doesn't put them up in his library in his room and says, come look at this. He stores them away as carefully as he can. And of course, he stores them in different places. Because guess what? He's heard the story of St. Paul's. And so he stored them all over the place. In fact, there's a famous book called The Lee Census. This is a book which, this is Sidney Lee, who was a Shakespeare scholar, who wrote a book who tried to catalog all the 200 or so first folios in existence and describe their physical condition, you know, marks and page missings and sort of things like that, what they were worth. So, and he was constantly hounding Folger, saying, what do you got, what do you got? And Folger would always say, thank you very much for your letter. You know, it drove Lee nuts. And Lee, by the way, would estimate, oh, he had, you know, 20 folios or something like that in his catalog, which by the time Folger already had like 60 or something like that. His one great loss, though, by the way, and this is why I come back to the Bodleian, was to the Bodleian. He sort of discovered the Bodleian toss-away copy with the little hook on the cover, and he says he tried to bid for that, but the Bodleian librarians said, no, that's ours. You've got to give it back, you know. And Folger's sort of remarkable argument in these very sort of professional, civil, you know, typewritten letters was, well, you got screwed up. You were the one who lost it in 1660. Why should I trust the Bodleian with it? It's better off with me. And it's a remarkable exchange that goes on for 3 or 4 years where he's battling with the Bodleian Library. The Bodleian librarians in great librarian form are trying to enlist all their alum, right? Oxford men, come out, we can't let another folio go to America. This crass American business, and you have to for the pride of England and all this kind of thing. Yeah, my God, even Cambridge men are willing to put up money for this. You've got to sort of come through. And in the end, it just turns out the only, I mean, it was great effort on behalf of the Bodleian librarians, but the owner, who was a rather cranky English aristocrat named Sibthorpe, his son happened to be at Oxford at the time in a very literary sort. And he finally said, Dad, enough. It goes to the library. So Folger lost that one to the Bodleian and never forgot about it. But he started, it was one of those things where he went to the grave believing that should have been his Bodleian and he would have taken it. That should have been his folio and he would have taken very better care of it. By the way, a wonderful book about this stuff that's just sort of come out, The Millionaire and the Bard. Speaking of great airplane books, for about 2 hours. Andrea Mays is an attorney by training and a former student of David Bevington's. And what she does in about 30 pages is she synthesizes the whole history of Shakespeare scholarship. And then she goes on to tell the sort of wonderful story of Henry Folger. So I'm doing a little promoting here for this Andrea Mays book. It's simply wonderful. It's really hard, as our librarians will tell you, to make some of this stuff interesting. You know, the four-year battles of how to get a book, but it's incredibly important. And she's actually mesmerizing. Donovan or Carolyn, I don't know if they're here, we had this discussion about creative nonfiction, right? This is really excellent craftsmanship. I mean, to sort of take these stories and make them as compelling as they are. By the way, here's a wonderful image, too, from the books. These are 82 copies of Shakespeare's first folio, which works out to 42% of the known existing copies. They rest on the shelves of the chilly subterranean vault of the Folger Shakespeare Library. This gives you a sense of what it looks like. I was going to say those are Ellen Barton's personnel files that the English department, and she let them sort of well organized and sort of things like that. But that's what the case looks like. Folger's wonderful, by the way. During the That's the inside of the Folger reading room. That's a 1949 picture. But the reading room still looks very much like that. I mean, there's not a fundamental difference. I mean, the table setup is different. Trying to think what else from that picture is. I can't really tell. But still, I mean, that's what the inside of the Folger library looks like. There's the outside. This is the exterior of the Folger Library. It's on East Capitol in Washington, D.C. It abuts the Library of Congress, and then this, next to what we just talked about, John, the Supreme Court. Curiously, this is one of those great curiosities, the Folger was designed by Paul Cray, the same architect who designed the DIA, and you can see the sort of tendencies. When we go back here, let me go back to the building of the Folger, because it's really remarkable. Folger, after he got all this collection together and he finally retired from Standard Oil, apparently all Folger liked to do was to be with his wife, to work for John Rockefeller, collect first folios, and golf. And the only, there's a wonderful picture that he got himself on the Golf Digest. He putted like a croquet racket style, which is looks like a remarkably silly picture. So I didn't put that up there because this is not a silly guy. But this is all he liked to do. So he took his money at the end of his life and he said, we're gonna build the Folger Library. He went to a number of places, New York, it was too expensive, Chicago, England tried to woo him back, and he said, you gotta be kidding me. I've done all this work to bring these texts over here to America. I'm not going anywhere back to England. These are gonna, and he looked at this piece of property in Washington, D.C. on East Capitol, and at the time it was a set of row houses, about 10 or 11 row houses, that were in okay shape, not great shape, and he started a 9-year process of buying them all up. He was very careful with his money. He didn't come say, I'm gonna buy them all in one fell swoop, because that would tip people off that the value of them had just gone up, so he hired 11 different realtoring companies, and he negotiated over the course of 9 or 10 years to get the property, to put the Folger Library there. So there's this kind of capital sort of, you can say that as rapacious in some way. But just as our rapacious businessman finally got his property, he gets a letter, and he's all said he's got his Folger plans, he's got his money. This is the late 1920s, we're sort of coming up on the Depression. He gets a letter from Washington, D.C., an eminent domain letter. It says, oh, we understand you're the new owner of this block on East Capitol. We need that property. The Library of Congress wants to expand. So Folger, rather than going to Rockefeller or, you know, calling the lawyers, et cetera, placed a simple call to the director of the Library of Congress, right? The librarian, and said, they said, can we work this out? And by the way, if we can't work this out, I'm taking my library someplace else.
Right.
And so the Library of Congress said, fine, would you agree just to keep this to a Shakespeare, Elizabethan sort of collection, that kind of negotiation, so you won't keep with us, you know, compete with us? And Folger said, essentially, what else is there to collect? So construction starts in 1929, in the middle of the Depression. Unfortunately, and this is the sort of really scary part, Folger dies at 73. They're really and his wife takes over, and when he dies, there's this great fret, and you know they come to the wife and Emily, and they say, you know, can we continue? You know, everything's collapsing. Do you have enough money to continue? And Emily said, well, of course. Henry planned for this. So not only had he planned enough to keep construction of the Folger going, he planned enough for the first 20 or so years of programming and operations. So extraordinarily farsighted and skilled in his business practices, not just in his sort of love of art. And part of the great story of Henry Folger, and one of the reasons I'm promoting that book, is Mays is quite adamant, I think in a useful way, about talking about healthy relationships between corporate America and business and academia at a time when those two entities are coming into collision again. The Folger story is really exemplary, I think, in some ways, about how you can have a productive melding of the two. And again, the building itself is extraordinary. This is the fourth, this vault is four levels down. The building of this, again, he was a shrewd politician. He wanted the outside to look like the rest of the buildings. That's why he hired Gray.
but he didn't want to give up on his love of Tudor England, his imagination of what, you know, a good Tudor English library would look like. So there's this great discrepancy between the outside and then the inside. There's a wonderful letter where, you know, he was a micromanager. He tracked every piece of, you know, funds. And there's a wonderful letter that comes along and says, you mentioned, he says to one of the contractors, he says, you mentioned something about air conditioning. You know, he said, what is this air conditioning? I assume it has something to do with the, you know, cooling the room. And so there's a response back explaining to Henry Folger what, you know, air conditioning. And he says, oh, that may be a good idea. I'm not so sure. We just assumed, you know, this is Washington, knowing it was in Washington, D.C. in the summer, we would have to close it down. Now, for, if you've ever been to the Folger, most of us go to the Folger in May or June or July, in Washington, D.C. in May or June or July is, you know, you're dripping when you sort of get off the train. And then you go into the Folger, and it's Arctic. The air conditioning functions as well as any, in fact, by the end of the day, you're, you know, and then you come into sort of the bright sky, so that air conditioning letter is wonderful. Sorry, I keep clicking backwards here. There's the Cray, the DIA. And this is the DIA European Art Gallery, which has been slotted to house. This is up, you know, up on the third floor. This is where the folio will be. In the back, you can't really see it here. That's that the portrait on the side there on the left is the Nightmare. I love that because it really gives me nightmares. It's the one with the little ghoul sitting on top. The Othello, there's an Othello dagger in the back. There's a It's an ornate dagger with Othello choking Desdemona on top of it. And here's a bit more information about the events we've got planned. And this is where I want to sort of open up things to people to think about, where you might want to join in, where you might want to help us out. We have an opening gala at the DIA on March 10th. The exhibit runs from March 10th to April 1st. During that time, Love's Labor's Lost is going to be at the Hillbury. We've got a wonderful academic conference, including great Shakespearean editor David Bevington and a brilliant scholar named Mary Crane from Boston is coming to the Bernath Auditorium.
Will that be open to the public?
Everything but the gala.
Okay. But the conference will
The conference is free and open to the public, and we're going to promote as much as we can. What we've done is we've gotten, because this was a competition, each state only got one, we invited every Shakespearean in the state. So we've got all the, you know, the Shakespeare folks from U of M, MSU, Hope College, et cetera, sort of coming. So it's the first time we've done this. You know, again, this is the participatory, communal sort of nature of it. So we're very happy about that. WSU Libraries is going to have, along with the folio itself, the Folger is putting together a wonderful, gorgeous sort of set of panels and some digital materials that our library is going to stage outside the Bernath Library, and that's where the academic conference will be. So we'd invite you to take a look at that. And our library is also going to be putting together our holding, some of our exhibition, including all the quarto facsimiles and things like that. At the Detroit Public Library, March 18th, Arthur is going to be giving a talk, the Mary Adelaide Hester talk at the library about the first folio. And the DPL exhibit is going to be going on, I think, from February. That's pretty well sort of set up. Jamie Goodrich, my colleague, has been working with Mark Moden over at DPL, and they've got a remarkable collection. The second edition and the fourth edition, they actually have sheets from the Merry Wives of Windsor from a first folio, and they've got another number of different artifacts to look at, and we're going to be running some archival workshops, too. Apparently, I am doing something called Knowledge on Tap, February 24th. And during this time, too, the Detroit Film Theater is going to be running a number of Shakespearean adaptations, and we're hoping to have a guest speaker there. In addition, we're running some K-12 workshops, so local public schools can participate and work with us as well. By the way, I just want to put, this is the wonderful list of the DPL holdings that we've put together. The 1623 edition of the Merry Wives of Windsor, that's printed from one of the first folios. It's just loose sheaves that we've got. And the second edition, the fourth folio, the Johnson work, the Shakespearean dictionary is actually quite rare.
19th century artifacts. So again, this is one of those, you know, who knew this was in Detroit? And really want people to get over to DPL and see what they have to offer. And lastly, I'll just leave with these two images. I think, again, in addition to celebrating Shakespeare, celebrating libraries, celebrating museums, these incredibly important institutions and their ability to collaborate and work together, I would love for this to be an ongoing discussion, given that this comes out of Henry Folger, of how academics can sort of work now within an incredibly complicated business world. That's a picture of Eli and Edith Broad up there, by the way, who's Broad Museum in LA. Those are very controversial sort of figures. We live in a different era than Henry Folger, but I think it's incumbent on all of us, particularly in the humanities, to figure out a stance of some sort, of how to engage with the folks that have the finances to do the very difficult things that we need to do, at the same time to make these works and things accessible to the general public, to the scholarship, without taking them over. At the moment, I think that's a very fraught relationship, and it's tipping in a direction that makes me very, very nervous. Rather than thundering critically about that, as is my training as an English professor, I would much rather start a larger conversation about how to more productively negotiate or live in this world. And we do have, again, Folger, I think, is an example of how the academic community, the arts community, can engage with those that have money that sometimes feel like, you know, the Huns are at the gate and they've got enough money to do whatever they want and we can't say anything about it. I think we need better strategies there. So thank you so much for your time and patience. Open it up to sort of questions and comments. But again, please take away from this. This is going to be a series of ongoing events. If you've got ideas, if you want to join with us, we've got a number of partners already. Please come talk to us.
That I think might be useful. First, I wanted to mention that partnering with Folger Library was the American Library Association. And I think that has really opened the field of this to libraries around the country that have sort of taken this up to work together. The second thing is just to mention that we have an exhibit coming to the Schiffman Medical Library near the end of October called Shakespeare's Humors. And this is an exhibit also dealing with Shakespeare, but obviously related to the medicinal parts of Shakespeare. And that will be down at our Schiffman Medical Library, also part of the National Library of Medicine, giving some ideas about Shakespeare and how he dealt with medicine in his place. So that's another activity that we have on tap.
When is that going to be?
That's at the end of October. Reception will be October 29th, and then it'll go into November.
Thank you.
And it'll be in the library on the medical campus.
Is there a website that shows all of this?
Not yet.
Not yet. We're
right.
Working on that.
Again, libraries,
Wayne State Libraries is working overtime, putting together sort of media, a nice sort of media package for us,
okay.
And so is the university sort of promotion office, but it's coming, but
and
not
it'll have the details of this conference and all that?
Yeah, exactly, and I'll get this information up, and we'll be promoting it as much as possible, but the key months, obviously, are sort of, you know, starting in February through April.
But here's this coming just next month.
That was a coincidence, you know.
It was totally coincidental.
Yeah, coincidence.
It's still a good coincidence.
It certainly was. We put it in our application.
Right. Mark?
Ken, when is the academic conference?
March, it starts afternoon of March 10th and then March 11th, all day March 11th. Lisa?
I have a historical question, actually.
Good, answers.
So the first folio obviously was a hugely expensive book, right?
Yeah.
Not something anyone could buy. I don't know if you said how many were printed. You know?
The best, nobody knows for sure. The best guess is 750. That seems to be the magic number that everyone has settled on. Mm-hmm. You know, and you know that's based on how many are existent now. and just looking at the finances of the timeline.
The right.
What would Jaggard have agreed to do?
Right.
You know.
Right. So too expensive probably for a vanity project. They were hoping that these would sell.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
What kind of, if someone bought the first folio, why would they do that? What kind of cultural capital would they gain by buying this text of plays of a playwright who'd been dead for, what, 7 years or so?
Yeah, that's a great question. Whether there was any, I would say, cultural collector's capital, are you looking specifically for at the time? Difficult to say. I mean, my felt sense, and this isn't a very good historical answer, my felt sense is that you're talking about, and you know, this is just after the theater boom, right? The most popular troupe, you know, had finished. These were incredibly popular plays, an incredibly popular troupe, incredibly popular actors. Everyone knew each other. And this is the first of its thing, you know, first kind of thing like that. So there would have been that kind of value to it. Collector's capital, you know, I don't know.
Yeah, there's a history of folios of major authors that's getting some momentum now. 1598 Chaucer, 1598 Collected Sidney, Johnson's work. So if they're looking for major contemporary authors to gather together in a prestigious publication, even though he's just a dramatist and a poet also, but Shakespeare is a good one to think about. There's also a history of marketing Shakespeare's name. You start to get his name appear on the title pages of quarters in the late 1590s, I think.
Yeah.
And that's unusual, because a play quarto is usually published with information about the title of the play, who performed it, and where. He's marketable, in other words. He's been marketable for a good 20 years. So that's some of the context.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
Go right ahead.
What's your presentation? Opened up for me was the whole issue of authentication and legitimacy. You've got that surrounding the figure himself, historically.
Right.
And then the whole question of what is fake,
yeah,
and what is real,
right,
in the way of an artifact,
yeah,
a textual artifact, but also his art, what is fiction and so on. Can't think of a writer who, around whom this kind of these kinds of questions circulate as intensely as Shakespeare.
As you're sort of hinting at, I think too, they're in the plays. I mean,
yeah,
that sort of playfulness of what's real, what's fiction,
yeah,
is sort of built into the,
yeah,
plays,
absolutely,
which they were constantly sort,
yeah,
of,
yeah,
playing with that trope.
Right. Right.
So when they bring it into what I'm calling marketing,
yeah,
which is probably isn't quite a word,
yeah,
it's no sort of surprise it's there. Which it just made me think is interesting about Folger, his prized copy. When he went to have his, it's a really bad portrait, but when he went to have his portrait painted with his wife, he came in and he took the subway in and he carried a folio in a bag, and the folio he had with him that he had his portrait painted in was the false folio, the 1619, the Pavier false folio, because that was one of the most expensive. But for whatever reason, Folger staged something of that same play,
yeah, yeah,
that you're talking about there.
So all the big questions, what's fiction and what is real and how much of it is created.
Well, right, even in the, sorry, I can never do these things fast enough, but even in the opening pages, this is Johnson, and back to Lisa's question, this is Johnson playing off Shakespeare. They've been doing this for years, ever since the Poets' War. They've been engaged in this sort of back and forth, which other, you know, how much of it is real artistic debate, how much of it is marketing? Where'd it go? Okay, you know, the opening pages, you know, the to the reader there, what Johnson says in the last line is, don't pay any attention to, you know, don't worry about the man, right? Don't worry about the man Shakespeare or the the style of this book or its condition, pay attention to what's in the text, right? Pay attention to what's in the text. And of course, then that's juxtaposed to this giant portrait, the Drewshaw portrait of Shakespeare. In other words, pay no attention to that giant picture on the other side of the page. Pay attention to what's the text. The man doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. So again, it's a sort of regular trope, or frankly, a way of thinking, juxtaposing rhetoric and philosophy. That's through all the plays. It pops up in the staging of the print editions.
Professor Fleming, in the introduction of this quarto, it says that there are 3 pages in the manuscript of the Book of Sir Thomas More, which many scholars believe to be in Shakespeare's own hand.
Yeah.
Where are those pages? And I guess they're not loaned out or anything. They won't be coming to Detroit.
No. I mean, that's a great thing. Museums like to keep certain things to themselves, for good reason. For example, one of the questions that's come up in all these discussions about the folios that are being distributed nationally is, which folios are coming? Okay, because if we're going to put them in a case and we're going to open them up to Hamlet Act 3, Scene 2, well, they're all different, and they range in value. And some are in incredibly good condition, some are in incredibly bad condition. And the Folger is not letting us know just yet which ones are going to be circulating. Now, it makes sense they're not going to circulate the most valuable ones.
When this facsimile was done by Carlton Hinman, he took pages from a whole vast number of folios, because any one copy might have a combination of proofread and corrected pages along with uncorrected pages. They didn't throw away flawed printout sheets. While the sheets were being printed, somebody would read them over. You may have, a half dozen or a dozen bad copies of that sheet. They used them all. So, and I think, and this may be an exaggeration, but there are no 2 copies of the folio that are alike.
That's correct.
Because of the corrected and uncorrected business.
So they're all different. By the way, Hinman was an amazing guy. World War II expert in reading aerial reconnaissance photographs. And so he was invented this optic reader called the Hinman Collator, which was used by the military and the CIA for years, which is this, now it would look to us a very sort of clunky mechanical device, but to compare very quickly the pages.
You superimpose the images of 2 pages from one another, and where they differ, it'll be flickering.
it's a cool little device.
Ken, we should acknowledge our DIA.
Maria Ketchum, who has been our DIA partner from the very beginning, and who has made life wonderful by providing us space and helping us with the grant, and so thank you, Maria.
I have a question. Someone mentioned about what was in Shakespeare's hand, and what do we have things that he wrote? I mean, so how does someone know, say that this
we have
is
a signature.
Shakespeare? That, I mean, if we have all these typed copies, how do you know what's Shakespeare? I mean, if he wrote his signature, where is it, and who has it? And there are no manuscripts, and how do you know that this is Shakespeare?
You don't, for sure.
There were 6 copies of the signature.
On legal documents.
On legal documents. Yeah.
The will, a couple lawsuits, and things like that.
All things.
But yes, I mean, when pressed, there are no manuscript copies. What you do have is a lot of what I suppose in court would be called circumstantial evidence, a ton of it, which is these are the guys he acted with, these were his friends, these are the plays his name is associated with. This is the back and forth between Jonson and Shakespeare, which you see both in this kind of extra literary or extra theatrical text, but also in the plays themselves. When you sort of go back to earlier plays, I mean, Jonson starts his playwriting career in the 1590s with a basically sort of saying to Shakespeare, the way you're writing plays sucks, right? The way you're writing plays is goofy, it's crazy. This is a strain, particularly the romantic comedies. There are too many monsters, there are too many odd happenings, there's sort of too much romance. It's not realistic enough. I'm going to take you dead on as an artist. And then within Johnson himself has all these sort of internal jokes about, he's got a step footman in every called Hamlet. There's a mass of, back to Dick's point, there's a mass of circumstantial evidence, including the plays themselves and the scholarship. But yeah, at the middle there is this hole or gap because we don't have, the authors. Maybe that'll turn up. I mean, this is always sort of the question that comes up. Maybe buried in some English countryside someplace, it'll be there.
The second and fourth folio of the Detroit Public Library will be showing. Do we know where they're going to be open, and will it change over the exhibit time so we can see different?
Yeah, one of the things. Yeah, we're going to try it with the second and fourth because, frankly, the DPL owns it, so they have obviously greater say over how it can be handled, and we're going to be having some workshops so that people get more of the kind of access to those texts that you would if you went to the Folger and got your card and approval and everything and had the appropriate people there watching how you were handling them. So with the second and fourth at the DPL, we're hoping to provide that sort of greater access that we just can't with the DIA based on the
strictures.
But
just from you, Joe Public, will I be able to see different
pages? Yes, certainly, the DPL, you certainly should be able to. That's where people will have greater flexibility. Yeah. The DIA, we're under the contractual obligation, it's got to be under the case, it's got to, I can't remember all that. there's a lot of language. The Folger has to be very careful, they're sending these things out. They never tried
since
this before.
Since they're all open to be or not to be,
yeah.
Is there some worry about light degradation during this time?
I don't think it's about that, I think it's just thematic.
The glass is such that there won't be any degradation.
There are requirements for the lighting, and I'm sure there are certain protections in the case. But and this is true of our prints and drawings. Once it's shown for 4 weeks, let's say, it doesn't see the light of day for several years. But that's all being addressed with how we're showing it.
And the center of all of this, the Holy of Holies, is the book.
Mm-hmm.
What's interesting is that we have PowerPoint showing the book, which is also a theater presentation. We have mixed media. But I wonder if maybe Arthur's going to do this. Can you talk about what's going to be said about the bookness of the book? Because that's what we're all going to walk through.
Right.
I'm enchanted by that. I could look at that forever.
But the book is the book.
Yeah.
Well, Arthur, what are you going to talk about?
Okay.
Well, that was the fastest answer. I forgot.
I
was basically going to...
The physical characteristics, the cover, the type of print, the paper, the layout.
I'll talk about the physical material embodiment of Shakespeare in print. But I want to give a broad lecture for a general audience on everything I know about Shakespeare.
But Jamie, same question, Jamie Goodrich, and Lisa's over here too, so we've got lots of book historians. Jamie Goodrich is working with the DPL, and one of her first loves is the book, right?
Yeah.
And sort of the material item. So in her workshops, there'll be more of those kind of discussions.
Thank you.
All right, let's thank you very much.